four community organizations I belong to are focused on. So last night, I was given this humble duty to say we are behind what the summit is trying to achieve. So that's the message that I can bring to Dr. Mimi. So you have done a great job for coming up with this summit. Now, that's my inspiration quote. Every time as I leave, after I face some challenges in Australia, the challenge for every person is to take difficult and painful times and turn them into something beneficial, something that makes you grow. And that quote has guided my way, my stay in Australia. Now, I'll be quick enough to go through a few slides that I have because I've been given limited time. To take away, those are the four messages, even if I may not say everything in detail, but just remember those four points. A girl child needs learner-centered resources, ongoing support, as well as empowering her to be assertive in the family, in the community, in the workplace, and then internationally. We need to build the girl child's capacity so that she can have that voice that can be heard across. I've already, of course, shown the video of the girl. Now, the reason why I showed that video clip of that girl at the beginning is just to give you evidence of the impact of being a woman leader in this context. It is hard work, and we have to accept it. We have to work three times harder than the normal. But again, you find that we are underrepresented in that leadership context. Another harsh truth is there are too many barriers. And what I want you to read just quickly to see that point three, and I'll quickly read through it. Too many barriers to break through despite progress in other areas. Inimical and cruel customary practices towards women, disproportionate access to education, resulting in the girl child not being enabled to go and actually stay in school, and endemic poverty affecting the woman are all barriers which contribute towards keeping women out of active leadership roles. The challenge then comes with shedding at modern perceptions of women's role in society, and this can only come with time and a can-do attitude. And I quote Betty Moore. Now, I will not go into details. Those are my inspirational stages in my life. I'll look at point three. How do you deal with parents who have issues with your accent? Imagine you're sitting in an interview. It has nothing related to speaking English. And at the end, you are asked, how do you deal with parents who have issues with your accent? And this reminds me of what Emma just said here. What we have to speak up against. How do we approach that need that we meet up to the English level, standards of the English levels? I had to swallow that bitter pill. And then look at number four. Even if they train you, they won't use you. And I've seen it happen, and it's there. It's a harsh truth, but it's there. Number six, that's out of personal experience, why I had to do this study whose report I am sharing today. I had to sit for IELTS three times. You ask me, what are you teaching? I teach English. And yet I failed, okay, in quotes. I didn't take it that I failed. It was just failure to meet the band seven in all the three words themselves, writing, reading, and then speaking and listening. Speaking, it was always 8, and then the 2 were played up. Reading, it will either be 6.5, writing, 7.5. Mm. And then next time I sit again, speaking, 8, and then writing will be 6.5, and then the reading will be 7.5. I had to swallow the bitter pill until my principal had to say, Rebecca, with your family, we will sponsor you under employer nominated visa. That's why today I'm here speaking to you. What you're going through, I've gone through. And as a teacher specialized in English as well as literacy, I'm there. Emma will use you. We will use your organizations that our voices must be heard so that our people who have good reasons for leaving their various countries should come here and find some peace abroad, peaceful abroad, and meet their dreams. Pardon me for losing myself. Just quickly, I'll not read everything. The context that built my paper, my study itself, and this is true, it's evidence-based. So I'll just quote Dooley, 2009. African refugee learners are some of the students who have significant challenges for a variety of reasons. Quote, with histories of little, no, or severely interrupted schooling, and that's true. Some of our brethren have gone through, they've been living in camps. What are we going to do with them? And then second, Africans with prior schooling, the Australian educational context often requires negotiating with new styles of teaching and learning. Now, in the West itself, you have informal and then didactic. It's less didactic, but more active and independent. How do our children cope with that? Issues of settlement, as well as trying to learn the language which they must use in school in order to understand or perform at the standard or beyond the standard in all the subjects that are delivered or they are required to learn at school. What are we going to do, my sisters and my brothers, about it? I'll not go through that. The PowerPoint will be shared through Dr. Mimi. So, a summary of the approaches. I'll just talk about scaffolding. The framework that I used for my study was a scaffolding approach itself. And I'll talk more about it when I come to the proper. Now, in our tradition, you find that it is rich oral tradition. That's it. And in this case, again, you have to think about useful within the scaffolding approach in the mutually adaptive learning paradigm. So, the approach that I used or explored how to support the girls from a background other than English is called a mutually adaptive learning paradigm. So when I say MAP, I just mean that. It's adaptive. It can be applied in different contexts. It has worked in Australia. I showed you a video clip of one of the African girls. It has worked. It can also work elsewhere. It can work in our African countries where we want. We can support our girl children in those contexts. I'll just show you the results of the study itself. But before I do that, that framework looks at accepting conditions for learning, combining processes for learning, and then focusing on new activities for learning. That's why it is called a scaffolding approach itself. So I've seen it work in our context, as well as those are mainstream students have benefited from it. Now, I'll just show you some graphs, because pre-writing learning needs. So the students had needs. I identified them in their writing. So I've used abbreviation, their point of view, and then you have a what? Audience, focusing on ideas, vocabulary, cohesion, spelling, paragraphing, sentence construction, and then text structure and punctuation. Those were their needs. And now you have pre and post intervention scores in EAL stages. And the colors tell you the ones that are up there. Those were the results after. Now I had taken the students through the framework itself using the pedagogy. And you can see these were very low at first. So you can see that this framework works. Okay, those were just some of the results. And you can see how there's a difference. Improvement in their sentence construction, but different types. Okay, now I'll go, that will mark just the two slides that I'll talk about. Now, the findings were, due to the adaptive nature of MAP itself, you find that the scaffolding approach enabled the teaching to integrate a different or a range of teaching strategies as well as learning strategies. And because of that, it accelerated or improved the writing performance of every student that are involved in that research. Then positive writer's identity again was improved. You know, we with an African background, we feel like I can't write. But when I took these students through this study, you find that they were now able to write, they were able to speak, to read, and so on. And then multicultural aids, at my school we have teacher aides, known as multicultural aides, who help students from different migrant backgrounds, and they support them to enhance their learning across the subjects. So it worked. So this framework can also work with, even if you are a volunteer, if you're a specialist in maths, whatever, you don't have a job, you want to volunteer, you come, you'll be accommodated in that. We can easily accommodate you. And then these are three-stage process effectively scaffolded writing for the EAL learners, but again, the mainstream students. And then finally, my recommendations. And I'll stop with that. If you look at number two, it says further inquiry could be engaged with science and mathematics teachers of students from a non-English speaking background to investigate ways in which MAP frame could be employed to support the students to enhance their literacy outcomes in the target subjects. And then number three, considering the ever-growing technological advancement, the study suggested further research, future research in literacy intervention project that could harness computers in the EAL reading writing classes to support the learners to write, to learn in English. And then finally, my recommendation from there is we could trial MAP in the African context too. Thank you.
Introducing yourself, and then I'll give you everyone 3 minutes, so maybe we can start.
Hi, good afternoon everyone. My name is Naveen Al-Rafai. I'm a business lady, just been dealing in business for the past 25 years of my life. Australian born and been educated as well overseas, and we've got quite a few different companies around representing Asia, representing Australia, and representing the Middle East.
Hi everyone, my name is Tahira Sheikh. I've got a background in leadership and management and currently working on a social enterprise.
name is Patricia Kintia. My background is quite diverse. I've actually worked in different sectors, including the corporates, multinationals, and over the years worked for myself before actually joining the education sector, which I fell into. I guess it wasn't by accident, it was because somebody identified that I had the talent to do so and I was provided that opportunity. So for about 15 years now, I've been in the education sector and worked in the vocational education sector as well as a university, but done training in workplaces for various organisations. Currently work at Swinburne University of Technology.
Is all about interacting with community and listening, understanding people before you go ahead and move forward in your business. I've worked in several countries, not only Australia. I worked in America, I worked in Egypt, I worked in Japan. I have to say, if it wasn't for people, I would have not been in business. So people made me as a successful business person because I always seek their advice. And if we're going to get back to kind of leadership, and that's the whole idea of a leadership, I think the leadership comes from the community, from people around you, before it comes from yourself.
I will have to start by saying, like I just mentioned, I'm working in a social enterprise, so it is a business, but it's a very small project that we're working on, which is trying to tackle a social problem that we have at the moment. So my way of looking at business is, yes, I do agree with Naveen. There's a lot of listening and a lot of patience you have to have with everyone you're working with. And be a role model yourself before you expect people to listen to you. So. In leadership, have that skill with you that you're able to listen and be a model for everyone else.
My advice is, I guess, having worked in different sectors, that it is not easy to actually be in business, but it is not an impossible mission either. So never take that as being a challenge that nobody can overcome. It is a challenge that everybody has the capacity to overcome if you believe in yourself, if you also use the opportunities that are provided to you. But if they're not provided, go seek those opportunities and create them. And you have to be able to also reinvent yourself when there are times where you actually have failures or challenges to face. Don't give up. Never give up. I think that's part of being in business, whether it is your personal business or somebody else's business. So it is about attitude, it is about behaviour, it is about making a difference and being true to yourself. I think that message has been quite strong throughout the conference. Knowing what you can do, but also knowing what others can do with you and be on that journey with you, because you can't always do it alone. And it is important to know that you have to build a network of relationships and be trusting and respectful of those relationships, because your strengths are yours and other strengths are ones that you can also leverage on when you are in business. So make the most of those opportunities and have that emotional intelligence to know about what you can do, but also about your limitations. So then you can work with others to work with them and bring them on that journey with you. So that's my personal message to you.
I just want to reinforce what Patricia's just said about networking and support. This is one of the places where you get that from. So coming to such conferences, it's really very important for anyone thinking of doing a business, is who can you speak to? How can you get support? Who can help you get more contacts or more opportunities? Where else can you go from here? So don't limit yourself to this only. You always have to walk out, go beyond what you can see.
Thank you very much. I have one more question for all of you. Like, for example, as Africa, when we start business, maybe we just, if someone is open a closed shop, the next door is closed shop, everywhere they say doing the same thing. Mm-hmm. This is like, what do you think as a business woman to like encourage, because women always they want to do, you know, their business. So, sorry, my
Yeah, so you just give some idea of what you think. Okay. Now, if we're talking about business, we need to understand the aspect of business and try to make sure that everyone got a plan. And from the plan, we need to study what we can do to achieve success. One door closed, we don't give up. We just need and seek advice and help from everyone around us that got the knowledge, that got the experience, and make sure that you always follow the right process this time, and just make sure that you've got someone always in place to give you the right head ups about everything. And you just need to ask, like, I've been asking Dr. Mimi, she's technically my mentor and my leadership in every way, because I use always to rely on her for knowledge and advice more than business advice. So never give up. So what you do is seek to the individual, seek to government. You've got a lot of government support to help you out and tell you what to do and not to do, and give you all the green lights from there. As well, I have to enforce the community, because we can't move forward except the community is always behind your back and helping you out.
I'd say with any market, the first thing you'd start with is do your research, do your background checks, do your research. With the shops you have next door, have a look at what they've got that you can, what they don't have that you can offer. So pick a niche market, so go down to what you can offer that's different from them. Mm-hmm. And I agree with Naveen, you do need a mentor, you do need that support from someone who's already in the business, to ask questions that you're afraid to find out or ask someone else. So your mentor should be someone you can trust, who'll be able to give you the right advice. But research is the best thing to do. Ask your friends, ask your families, what do they want to see in your shop that's not there in the shops next to you, or what do they want to see in your website that other websites are not offering. So niche markets is what's best. Yeah.
I want to build on what's been said, because all that is very true. And when you think about this key point of difference, know what is different about your business compared to those other businesses that are around you. What are you going to do that's different, that is going to attract a niche market? But it might not be a niche market. It might be something that distinguishes your personal brand. Now, it doesn't have to be a Nike brand. It can be very personalized. And I know we've seen very many successful small businesses, especially for women in entrepreneurship and social enterprise, especially if, you know, there's a movement of growth here in Victoria, and I'm energized to see that, because they are using what they're very good at, what they're talented at, their gifts, and they're putting that to work to be able to earn an income. So know your points of difference, know your strengths, and build on that. And I guess for me, it's also about integrity. So if you show integrity as a business person, you might be making that difference compared to other businesses that might not be as authentic and also as trustworthy as you are. So that's a key point I want to leave with you.
Thank you very much. If you want to say something, I'll allow you one answer.
I have to say, I always see all this beautiful young generation will be our leadership. And never hesitate to ask, never hesitate to find a solution. We're always there to support you. as kind of our knowledge and our experience as well. So hopefully we'll see you around every time if you've got a summit, and summit's a good opportunity for you to give you more of an honest relationship and leadership at the same time.
My message would be, have confidence in yourself. You know you can do it. And take pride in anything you do. Don't give up. It's not easy. It's not going to come in one day, but don't give up. Have confidence, take pride, have your contacts, go out there and you make it.
Excellent advice here. What can I add to this? I think, you know, something that resonates with me is be the change that you want to see. You know, for me, that is something that's very personal, and it's something that I take with me every day. It's not easy to change. It's not easy to be different. But what you want to see is it's something positive, and that's what drives me as a person. So I hope that as a person, you want to be someone that creates impact in this world. And what do you want to be remembered for? All the good things that you've done, the greater good that you've done, or is it for all those not really, could be newsworthy, but it may not be the right thing in terms of, you know, breaking the laws, for example. So just be careful about that, and remember that. What do you want to be remembered for? What's your legacy to this world? Whether it is in business or in community. So business leadership and social leadership for me are two things that I say that they're actually, you know, the same. I am the person I am, and I do what I do in both fields the same way. So I won't change that for anything at all. So be true to yourself.
I know Rebecca is not on the timetable now, so
Please join us, Rebecca.
I just wanted to give a comment with regards to her own business, which appears to be teaching. Being a teacher, I've been privileged to teach across the 3 tiers of education. I taught in the primary school, I taught in secondary school, I taught in the university, or I'm teaching in the university. So, yeah, there are. She made a comment on the issue of access, and many people of African origin are going to encounter that from time to time, especially if you are in the classroom. What I need to tell you, and anybody aspiring to teach or even be a public speaker, is to be aware, or let the people who confront you be aware, that everyone has an accent, except you are dumb. If you are not able to speak, then you won't have an accent. In England, where we get this language from, there are more than 5 different accents. I'm not talking about the Welsh, the Scottish. I went to school in Aberdeen, and I almost could not understand them the first day I arrived. And interestingly, the first African I met at Aberdeen was from Zimbabwe. And he couldn't understand me, I couldn't understand him. Today we are the best of friends. Finally we came to understand each other. So this accent thing is there. The Victorians speak different from the New South Welsh people. Go to South Australia, they are more British than the other Australians. The Queenslanders speak differently. So just be aware and let them know that you come from a different background. Just be able to handle the standard language. That is the most important thing.
Mm-hmm.
And again, being with the fact that Australia has, we now have a lot of people from refugee backgrounds who may have arrived without any English, I draw from something my professor told me when I arrived in Aberdeen in 1989. He told me, Paul, just be aware when you get on the street, they are going to ask you maybe where do you come from? what have you come here to do? And then they wait for you to say, oh, my name is Paul, I'm from Africa. That is what they are waiting to hear. But then when you string a sentence in 5 seconds, then they are shocked. And the next thing is, oh, he has an accent, I couldn't understand him. So just be aware of those things and be, just tell them everyone has an accent.
When someone asks you, where are you from? Because obviously, you know, you look different to what they do. My answer to that, and I do that very often, very cheekily in networking places that I go to, and I can tell you, there could be VIPs, I couldn't care less. Politely and respectfully, I'd say, oh, I'm from Endeavour Hills, Victoria, or Hyatt, Victoria, where are you from? So when I say that, they will turn around and go, oh, no, I mean, where did you come from? What country were you born in? And I'm going, oh, that's an interesting conversation. Do you have all night? So I think it's important to build on that, okay? So that you challenge them.
Maybe some of you might ask, how did you handle that? After, you know, the first reaction is to swallow a bitter pill. However, I immediately turned to a friend who listens. So I've got someone at my workplace who listens. When I shared this with her, she's from the mainstream, she's not African. She said, Rebecca, don't worry. What do you teach? English. So you think this school could have employed you if your English was all that bad? And it dawned on me, I said, oh yeah, this is a reality, it's true. If my English was all that bad, even my accent, that school could have not employed me to teach their children English. Full stop.
Thank you very much. And maybe, I think we can have one question, maybe. And then we will see if we have time. So maybe.
Good afternoon. My name is Kolu. What do you do if you have a passion for something and you want to do a business but you don't know the way out?
Wait. You mean a way into
yeah,
that business?
Yeah, starting a business and how can you be connected?
Okay.
Yeah, to things that you want to do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, okay.
Want to do things that you want to do a business, or you don't know where to go, you don't know who to talk to, yeah, but you really want to do the business.
So I think it's important to be aware that there are opportunities and knowing where they are. It's not easy to find them.
Yeah.
And it's not that hard to find them either. So we talked about networking, we talked about mentoring. So finding somebody that is in that field or a field that's similar to help you find the information is really important. And I'm happy to have a conversation with you about that because that's part of my work that I do. It's about helping people identify their skills, but also then being able to find a pathway on getting there. So I'm happy to do that. I don't do that for money, and I'm happy to give you my time.
Thank you.
The only thing I would add to that is there's a lot of support from governments here. You just need to tap into that. So yes, Patricia's got really good ideas and speak to her, but also look at how you can get information online on government websites here and network support from such conferences.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. My name is name is Annie. I'm from the Liberian community. My question here is, how do we support our children in school? Because sometimes some of our children from the background of non-speaking English, they come home with her homework. And as a mother, I don't have the idea how to even do math or science. I left school a long time ago, and I don't know how to do it. They will tell the child to go on the internet to do research for themselves. What, which help do you have to get to the parent?
Thank you very much. We run out of time. I believe everybody, they have a very important question. But we just
can she see me later?
Yeah, and I'm also happy to talk to you.
I want to
say Rebecca as well.
Just for answer to her just quickly, just give her a short answer and
I'll give a very quick answer to your question. I know that the community centers, all community centers have homework clubs,
yes,
where you can get help for the children who cannot, whose English is second language, or who are struggling in school. So homework clubs in community centers.
Can I also add that there is a bit of a shift in that, because it is identified as being an issue. And it's not an issue that can't be overcome. It is up to the institution to start investing time and money. And that's what we need to lobby for at an institutional level, which is for the schools themselves to create programs where they're not only supporting the students, but supporting the parents, so the parents can be learning and also helping their children at the same time. So there is a movement of that happening, and there are some schools that are trialing some projects at the moment. And I know certainly at university level, which the sector that I work in, we are starting to do more in that space, perhaps not engaging the parents as much, but providing them a reassurance that their children will have a support system and access without having to pay any extra money to be able to do the programs that will help them with their English language, their academic writing skills, and help them get through their courses, so they're not paying for no reason and have no outcome at the end. So that's one change that I'm seeing in the education sector. So rest assured that we need to lobby the government to do more in that space. And it needs to happen not only at the tertiary level, primary and secondary level. So I hear what you're saying. It's not easy, but there are the homework support groups, and it's important to know where they are, because that's the solution for now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'm happy our panelists, if you have any question, just discuss after, because we run out of time. So it's really important.
You might as well just finish.
Yeah, we need to finish, so that's why. Anyway, it's very important. We need to keep in touch. And when we finish, still they have to ask, and then I think our panelists, they are happy to answer.
Absolutely.
So feel free to ask. But I'm so sorry.
You can let her finish the last response.
What I wanted to say is, it is indeed true that in our schools, there are homework clubs. I am a homework club coordinator at my school. We run that once on a Wednesday after school, and the lowest number of attendance is 20, the highest number, 110.
Yeah, wow.
It works.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your time.